take up every corner of my mind.
What you gonna do now?
You know you could tell me.
Good morning, St. Mark's. Great to have you with us. I'm Rachel, this is Phil, and we lead St. Mark's together. We are a community of people who love Jesus, who worship Jesus, who seek to follow Jesus. And we want other people together to find faith in Jesus, to find freedom, and to see this amazing city of Coventry flourish. That's our vision. And it's great to have you with us. If you're here in the buildings, particularly if you're new, if it's the first time for you or the first of a few times, great to have you with us this morning. And also welcome to anyone joining us online.
Good morning online.
It's a great way to connect if you're not able to be here or if you've never been to church before and you're just dipping your toe in. But nothing beats being together. So we're really looking forward to seeing you here with us soon too.
Yeah, it's great to be here in person. Great to have you with us this morning. We've got a great service coming up this morning. Lots happening. Now, the format this morning is slightly different. Just to warn you, if you're a regular here at St. Mark's, don't be put off if things happen at a slightly different time to normal. We're going to be singing some songs to start off with. We're going to be praying together as church. And then we're having a short break. And that's the point at which our kids and our youth groups will begin. The rest of the service will work pretty much in the ways that you're used to. But for the adults, because we're going to be talking a little bit about communion in our sermon this morning, Rachel is going to be preaching to us. The response today is going to be communion for the adults as we draw our time together to a close, which will be about midday, there or thereabout. We'll be finishing with refreshments and some very delightful cookies. So we hope you can stay for that and join us for that time.
There's a book in the Bible called Psalms, and verse 1 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." And that's who God is. He's good, and his love endures forever. That's true whether we are in joy or in sorrow, whether we are walking lightly or whether we are carrying weight. That's true when our whole world seems like it is upending. And so we're going to declare it together. Would you stand with me? Let's declare it together. Let's declare it to God. Let's declare it to our own souls. Let's declare it to each other. I'm going to say the first sentence, then if you could join in. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Let's worship him.
Okay, we're going to start with God is good. So can I encourage, particularly families, if you want to come to the front and worship with us down here, come forward, let's make some space. I just really want to encourage us this morning to be free and to move our bodies and go for it in worship. So let's sing together. Here we go. Let's clap our hands together. Here we go.
Good smiles, others with fears that they face. Here we come, ready to bring who we are.
Sing another song now called I Thank God. And again, I want to encourage you to just go for it. The joy of the Lord is our strength. We dance this morning because we're free. We celebrate because Jesus is alive. So let's worship together. Also, I need to play my guitar for this one, so I can't move as much. But just because I'm not moving doesn't mean you can't move. I'm just saying. going to go for it. Ready? And I want to see the whole room move. We're going to go around the chorus just one more time. And then we're going to sing again, okay? So just give it all you got. Go. In one, two.
Don't lose the energy. We're going to pray together, but we're going to do this together. We're going to pray, and I need the energy and I need your enthusiasm as we pray together. We're going to start by praying for those near to us. Perhaps you could just use your hands and just do this with me, okay? That's a sign and a symbol that we're going to pray for those near to us. And what I'd like you to do in just a minute's time is talk to the people either side of you, maybe somebody just next to you or near to you. I'd love you to know their name. Maybe you might need to introduce yourself. You may well know their name. But just make sure you know who they are and see if there's anything they might want prayer for this coming week, if they're comfortable with that. So I'm just going to give you about 30 seconds. Parents, you might need to chat to your kids, saying, hopefully you know their name. Just chat to your kids and say, how can I pray for you this week? Kids, you might want to ask your mums or your dads or your carers, is there anything I could pray for you this week? Okay, you've got about 30 seconds just to chat to your neighbour, introduce yourself and say, how can I pray for you this week? Go. Okay, we're going to have to be quick. We've got a number of things we're going to pray for. Okay, you're going to get about 20 seconds to pray. Let's all pray out loud. Pray out loud and pray for your neighbor. Let's go. Lord Jesus, we just want to pray, Father. We want to pray for our neighbors. I want to pray for those. Lord, I want to pray for Andy in the band. Lord, I want to pray for David. Lord, as they're being prayed for, God, would you bless them this week? Would they know your presence? Would they know your peace? Would they know your love? Would they know your power? Lord Jesus, we pray. Great. Let's slow it right down. Shh. We've got one or two more things we're going to pray for. Shh. Now what I'd love you to do is to stretch your arms up high as you can. Because what we're going to do now is to pray for those above us, those who are in authority over us. So what I want you to do is to think about, who's in authority over me? Kids, you might think, well, that's my mum and my dad. That might be your teachers. That might be your boss. That might be your MP. That might be your bishop. That might be your grandparent this week. Whatever it is, somebody who's in authority over you. So just make sure you've got somebody in mind. Parents, you might need just to check with your kids so they can think of somebody who's in authority, somebody who's above them, somebody who's in charge. All right? And then we're going to just pray out loud again for those in authority. Just pray that God would bless them. Pray that they would know God's love. pray that they know God's goodness. We use that verse to begin with. Let's pray. Let's pray out loud now. Lord Jesus, I want to pray, Father, for those in authority. Lord, I want to pray for the bishop who's right now at St. Peter's Hillfields, blessing them. We pray for her this day. Lord, I want to pray for our MP, for Zara. Lord, we want to pray for our prime ministers. We want to pray for, Lord, our those in authority, for the decisions that they make, for our teachers, God, for our bosses in this city. Thank you, God. And then very lastly, I'm going to ask you to be very still and very quiet. Can we be very still and very quiet? Because the last thing we're going to do is we're going to pray for peace. Some of you might know that at the moment in some parts of the world, there are big arguments. People are at war. Just in the last 24 hours, some of you will know in the news there's been reports of yet more war and more weapons being used. And so maybe together we can all pray for God's peace. Let me lead you in this. But we're going to be peaceful ourselves as a sign of God bringing peace. So very quietly, we pray, Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for peace in your world. We pray for peace, particularly in the Middle East today. Peace between Iran and Israel. We pray for peacemakers to be raised up, those who will fight for peace. We pray for the politicians that they would pursue peace. And for all the places in the world where there is conflict, Ukraine and Yemen and many other places, this morning, all together, we pray for peace. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys are wonderful. I love the way you pray. Thank you so much. Thanks, bands. Guys, we are going to have a short break now. We're going to be playing some music. It's an opportunity to chat to your neighbors. You might want to carry on conversations about what you prayed for them that's coming up this week. But also, our kids groups are now open, and our youth group is now going to go and meet. So God bless you. Do take your kids off to their relevant groups. We'll play some music, and we're just going to come back together again in a couple of minutes' time.
Faithfulness to me.
Great. Well, do please carry on your conversations later on. There'll be lots of time at the end of our gathering to have teas, coffees, refreshments. Do stick around and get to know us a little bit more at that point in time. But there's a few things we'd love to tell you about. Firstly, if you consider yourself a member of St Mark's, we would love it if you would sign up to something called the Electoral Roll. That's a mechanism, a scheme within the Church of England, which basically means you just put your name down on the piece of paper on a list which says, yes, I consider myself a member of this church. If you've done that before in previous years, you don't need to do it again. You only need to do that once. If you're unsure if you're on the electoral roll, if you come and chat to us at the end, we'll be able to look you up and tell you. But we're conscious there are a number of new people who have joined the church, and you might want to say, yes, this is who I am. This is the church that I consider my home. And we'd encourage you to sign up to put your name down on the electoral. There are forms just by the top of the stairs there. Fill one in and post it in the little box that's there, and that will enable you to put your name and be part of what is called our annual meeting. That is going to be happening. I think I got the date wrong last week. Can you believe that?
I don't know, because I can't actually see the... I can't see anything on that slide.
Can anyone see anything on that slide beyond annual parochial church meeting?
Does anybody know the date of the APCM?
I know the date. I do know the date this week. The date is Thursday, May the 2nd. And so please keep that date free, few weeks' time, because that will enable you both to look back with us and hear some of the things that have been going on, but also look forward and join with us as we plan and we think about what is to come. Mm. In particular, on that day, on, let's say it again, Thursday the 2nd of May, there will be an opportunity to vote in new members onto our what we call our PCC, our Parochial Church Council. This is a group of people that are responsible for the governance of St Mark's, particularly in relation to things like staffing, finance, and buildings. And we've got a number of places that are coming up on the PCC. And if you would like to join that group, if you're interested in joining that group and you have some of the skills that you think could be useful, this coming year we're going to be particularly focusing on buildings and how we renovate and repair and redevelop the buildings that we have here. If that's something that interests you and you'd like to be part of that, please come and speak to myself or a member of the clergy team, and we'll tell you a little bit more about what it involves and how you can sign up and put your name forward to see if you'll be voted on at the annual meeting. So please think about that. Please come and chat to us if you want to know more. But the forms are all at the back, and don't miss out on the opportunity to come out, be part of that meeting and join us on May the 2nd.
Amazing. Following that exciting notice, I just want to talk a little bit about Alpha. So we run the Alpha course here, which is just a fantastic way to explore faith in a really low-key setting. Everyone is welcome. It doesn't matter what you believe or don't believe. In fact, the more different views we have in the room, the better the Alpha course is. And there's no question that would be thought of as too small or perhaps too big or too silly. Everybody is welcome to just bring what they want to bring to that setting. We're starting another Alpha course. We weren't going to do one, but we love it so much that we couldn't resist. So Phil's going to be starting the next Alpha course on Tuesday, the 30th of April. One of the reasons we're doing it is because last term it was just so exciting to see people come to faith and people to have their faith perhaps strengthened or themselves empowered in different ways. So we just see the fruit of this. And so we'd just love you to be involved. If you've never done Alpha, then why not sign up? Because when you know how good it is, you will want to invite your friends. So why don't you come and do it and bring a friend? Or if there's someone you know who would just really value that opportunity with no pressure, just to think about big questions of life and faith, then just have the courage to invite them, because it can be so life-changing. It can be the greatest gift that you can give to someone. So we're just going to have a little video which shows a little bit more about the Alpha course.
Life moves fast, doesn't it? Every day there is so much to fit in. But do you ever stop and think, what's the point of it all? Do you ever ask yourself, is there more to life than this? Alpha is a series of sessions exploring life, faith, and meaning. It's a space to explore the big questions, to say what you think and hear other people's points of view. First up, there's food, then a talk, followed by a discussion. Each talk explores a different aspect of the Christian faith, and then in a small group, you get to say exactly what you think. The aim of the talk is to spark conversation, each week unpacking a different question. There's no obligation to say anything, and there's nothing you can't say. Seriously. It's an opportunity to hear from others and contribute your own perspective in an honest, friendly, and open environment. Why not try it out?
That's Alpha. Come and join us. I'll be running that in a few weeks' time. I've already got a number of people who are joining me on this terms course, so please come and think about joining us and being part of that. We're going to have a great time together. The last thing we'd love to tell you about is what we call prayer ministry. If you've been part of St. Mark's, you will know that one of our values here is encounter. We long for people to encounter God. Every time we get together, we long for people to encounter God, be that on Sundays or at student groups or at connect groups or at Alpha, whatever the context, we hope and pray people will encounter Jesus. And one of the ways that we realize that, one of the ways we press into that, is by praying for people, by doing prayer ministry, usually at the end of each gathering, as well as in a range of different contexts. And to try and facilitate that to a greater and greater degree, we would love everybody in the church to be trained in how to pray for somebody to be filled with more of God's presence, more of God's power, more of God's spirit. And so to that end, we're going to be running a couple of training events on Tuesday the 23rd and the following evening, Wednesday the 24th of April. That's in a week and a bit's time. The Tuesday night and the Wednesday night. So they're identical courses. You don't need to come on both unless you're really keen. But you could come on one of those and learn what it is to be trained and what it is to pray for people to be filled with more of the Holy Spirit. And I don't know about you, I think it's about one of the most exciting things.
It's my favourite thing. It's my favourite thing, praying for people.
More so than preaching?
It's quite close, but I love seeing God meet with people. That is my favourite.
It is great, and I can just tell story after story of how God has just stepped in and touched people as I've been privileged to pray with them. And so if you'd like to be part of that, it's open to anybody within the life of the church, and it happens on that Tuesday night and that Wednesday night, 7:30, you don't need to sign up, just come and be part of that. And we're also going to be, it's part of what we're doing to begin to build a team of trained individuals who will be available to pray here on Sundays morning and evening. It's part of that process. So if that's something that interests you, if you're up for that, do come along on Tuesday the 23rd, Wednesday the 24th, and be part of prayer ministry training.
And I mean, also, if you sit there and think, oh, I'm just, it's a bit embarrassing coming forward to be prayed for, it gives you kind of an inside story on what it might look like and feel like for someone to pray with you.
We practice on the course.
We do have a practice, which is, we've got some funny stories about the practices as well, which we won't tell now.
No, we won't.
But we might tell them on the night.
Yes. Come along if you want to know more.
Come along to prayer ministry training. It is so exciting to be able to pray with people and see God meet them. And then if you're new to the church, or maybe not that new, but just don't really feel you've connected with your people here, then at the end, by the connect sign, the connect area, Johnny, who is, do you want to stand up, Johnny, in the yellow cap? It's great he wore a yellow cap.
Thanks, Johnny.
Without even knowing he was the connect host. This is Johnny, he's our academy leader, and he's going to be able to connect you in. So if you just want to hear a little bit more about ways you can get connected into the life of the church, we really don't want anyone to feel like they're on the edge. So go and talk to Johnny, and he will help you make the next steps.
We're going to be hearing from Rachel in a few minutes' time. But just before we do that, there's an opportunity to think about what we might give to the life of our church. It's part of our worship. Actually, we've been worshiping God already in terms of singing. We've been worshiping God in terms of praying. We can worship God with our wallets as well. What's how we use our finances. And our encouragement to you is just on a regular basis to consider how you're using your money, whether that's in alignment with the way God would want to have you use what he has given you. And to do that, we'd encourage you to think about giving to the local church as part of the way that you use the resources that God has gifted you with. And if you want details of how to do that, they are available on a screen just in a minute or two's time. But also, more particularly, they'll be available on our website, and there are details again at the back. If you want to know how to give to St Mark's, or how to review your giving, or how to update your giving, do come and chat to us. We'd love to tell you more about that. I think that is everything
that is
we need to say. So with no further ado, Katie is giving us our reading. Katie, why don't you come up? Katie is going to share our reading just before Rachel comes and speaks to us. We're continuing on in the story, looking at what happened to Jesus after the resurrection. You may know last week we looked at the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. We're picking up on that story from last week, just reviewing that. And then Rachel's going to be speaking into the next section, and Katie is going to tell us what that consists of. Katie.
Thank you. This week's reading is taken from Luke 24, verses 28 to 49. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do your doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high."
Thank you so much, Katie. Amazing. If you haven't met, my name's Rachel, and I'm on the leadership team here, and it's a privilege to be talking to you this morning. I always feel like I could start with a confession. giving you a bit of insight into my life. But do keep the passage open. We're in Luke 24. You may want to just keep your, if you've got it on your phone, keep it open. Put your phone into airplane mode if you're like me, tempted to be distracted by all the notifications coming in. Anyway, that wasn't my confession. This is my confession. So I'm not sure how many of you got caught up in the recent Kate Middleton conspiracies. And I have to admit that I got really, really sucked into it. Now, we now know that, unfortunately, her absence from the public eye is due to a really serious health diagnosis. But before this was announced, and as the pressure was mounting from the public to prove that Kate was okay, Kensington Palace sent out this picture. Now, but people were quick to jump on the fact that this photo had been tampered with, which caused even more problems and speculation for the family. People, and probably experts who looked closely at the photo, focused on, amongst other things, the fact that the hands gave it away. Princess Charlotte's hand was cropped wrong against her cardigan. Prince George's hand was blurry. Prince Louis's fingers were crossed in a really unnatural way. Apparently you can't cross your fingers that way. And Kate's hand was cropped really harshly. The hands gave it away. The hands told people whether this image was real or not. And far from like alleviating people's concerns, this photo caused the pressure to mount up to prove that Princess Catherine was okay. People were not going to be accepting of what they were told. They needed proof. And we are the same when it comes to Jesus. I wouldn't expect you to believe in Jesus just because I told you he was real, or because maybe you went to church as a child or your family went to church. Anyone who has done an Alpha course, and there is one running here in a few weeks, knows that the historical, the non-Christian evidence that Jesus existed is compelling. Nikki Gumbel, who wrote the Alpha Course and who founded the network that we are part of as a church, he set out whilst a student to prove that Jesus did not exist, as he was so disturbed by his close friends becoming Christians. But when he looked into it, he found the evidence that Jesus existed overwhelming, and he gave his life to Jesus. There is more evidence for the existence of Jesus than there is for Caesar. There are 17 extra biblical non-Christian sources, which is actually pretty extraordinary for the ancient world. If you're a historian, this is like I'm speaking your language here. But in combination, they contain a surprising amount of information concerning the life and death of Jesus. 11 mention his death, 5 speak of his crucifixion. So historians, not Christians, historians widely accept these sources. Jesus existed. So as Jesus existed, we need to ask ourselves who he is. The Bible says that he is the Son of God. And on his own reluctant conversion to faith, C.S. Lewis, who wrote all the Narnia books, said that Jesus was either a lunatic, a liar, or the Lord. He says, "You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse." Last week, Hannah spoke, and if you haven't heard it, go and back, watch it on YouTube. It was brilliant. Hannah spoke how we can know this in our heads. We can know in our heads that Jesus existed, but we need to know it in our hearts. And as we've already said today, as a church, one of our values is encounter. Because we know the only thing that is truly going to bring change to any of our lives is encounter with Jesus. We can sing great songs about Jesus, and we do. And we can speak to you about Jesus, and we can fill your heads with concepts and quotes. And that might help us to engage our brain and our intellect. But what is really going to change your life is encountering Jesus. And we want everything we do here to be about that goal, encountering Jesus, because it is only Jesus who will bring the transformation we long for. It is only Jesus who can heal us physically, who can heal us emotionally. It is only Jesus that can give us true peace, true joy, true fulfillment. And it's only Jesus who can give you real value. So how do we encounter Jesus? What does it mean for us today to encounter Jesus in our life? What does it mean for us to encounter Jesus here today at St. Mark's? Well, it's the hands that give it away. Turn with me. So we're in Luke 24, verse 28. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. Firstly, Jesus wants to be invited into your life. Now, in the passage, Jesus has walked, this is on the road to Emmaus, Jesus has walked along with the two disciples, but he only stays with them because he is invited to by them. He only comes in and enters in where he is wanted. He will only come into our lives and our situations if we invite him in. One way we can encounter Jesus today is by inviting him into our lives. One of the most beautiful paintings of Jesus, in my humble, not expert opinion, is The Light of the World by Holman Hunt. It's a really funny, it's like long, so whichever way you put it on the screen, you can't really see it, but it's beautiful. You've probably seen it before. And it shows Jesus knocking at a door. It's based on Revelation 3:20, which says, when Jesus says, "Here I am, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with them." But the door in the painting, it's very famously, has no handle on the side Jesus is standing. This painting shows that Jesus will not force himself into anyone's life. The door has to be opened by me and you. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are knocking, waiting to be invited in. For some of us, our encounter with Jesus today will be inviting him into our lives. For some of us, that will be opening the door to Jesus for the first time because you've never actually asked Jesus to come into your life for yourself. And if we have already invited Jesus into our lives, where have we pushed him back outside the door? What areas of our life is Jesus still standing on the other side of the door? Do we need to invite Jesus into our desires? Do we need to invite Jesus into our longings? Do we need to invite Jesus into our fears and our failures? Do we need to invite Jesus through that hidden door that no one else knows is there? The invitation is to daily, hourly open the door to Jesus for him to come into all areas of our lives. Jesus is knocking. Let's move on in our passage. So when he was on the road to Emmaus, it says in verse 15, the disciples on the road to Emmaus, it says that as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. And in the passage we've heard read, while the disciples were gathered, it says, while they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them. So how do we encounter Jesus today? These verses show us that Jesus is standing next to you. Jesus is waiting to be invited in, but he is standing next to you now. At Christmas, if you made it to any of our Christmas gatherings, we always think about how Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. And at the Christmas gatherings, quite a lot of us, we read this reflection. I'm going to read it again because it's just so powerful. Emmanuel means God with us. That means he is with us in A&E, in the divorce lawyer's office, during exams, changing nappies. He is with us in prison, on the first date, during the ugly cry, in the drop-off line. He is with us in therapy, at the checkout, in the delivery room, doing dishes. He is with us on the bus, at the custody hearing, at the table, in AA. He is with us in the waiting room, during chemo, in recovery, at the funeral. He is with us today, tomorrow, on December the 25th or April the 14th, and every day after. He is with us today. If we always come to church, if we never come to church, if we were invited, if we just decided to come along, he is with us today if we are excited, if we are disappointed, if we are exhausted or happy or sad or peaceful or lonely. Jesus is Emmanuel. Jesus is God with us now. Now, one of the disciples, Peter, he knew the difference of having Jesus stood right next to him. There's a famous account, it's in Matthew 14, when the disciples are in the boat and they see Jesus walking on the water. So Peter steps out of the boat and walks towards Jesus. Oh, that's really tiny. I'm sorry, you can't read that. But you know the story anyway. And it says in verse 30, it says, but when Peter saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. In other translations, it says he reached out and grabbed him. Jesus didn't hesitate. He reached down and grabbed his hand. He stretched out his hand. He extended his hand. Wherever we are, whatever we are doing, however far we may feel, Jesus is standing next to us. We are always within the grasp of Jesus. We are always within the grasp of Jesus. Jesus isn't absent. He is present. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are waiting to step in, to reach out to us, to know the comfort of the touch that reveals the presence of Jesus. I've got a little boy called Jack, and he turned 9 on Friday. Very exciting. But the day after he was born, he stopped breathing, and he was resuscitated, and we had to spend the next few weeks in NICU. We called on the name of Jesus. We shouted and cried out the name of Jesus. And he turned up. He was there in ways that I could spend the next few hours explaining. Jesus was there. For some of us, our encounter with Jesus today will be calling on him to step into our situation and either know his presence as we stay in that place, or know the rescue of being pulled out of it like he did with Peter. Let's move on. Verse 36. So while the disciples were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. And it makes me think of a time that we were invited to Jack's nursery. He's a bit older at this point. We were invited to Jack's nursery to see his classroom. Now, we told Jack that we would be in later weeks, and we explained what would happen. We warned him that we would be appearing. But when Jonty and I walked in to the nursery, Jack just couldn't comprehend what was going on. And he was terrified. And he ran to his teacher and hid behind her. He was absolutely terrified. Despite all the warnings that Jesus had given the disciples about his death, despite all the ways Jesus had spelt it out to them what would happen, the disciples were showing signs of trauma, understandably. They were confused and in disbelief. They didn't know what to do. But Jesus knows what they needed in that moment. They needed the peace that only his presence can bring. Jesus can give you what you need. Whatever you're feeling at the moment, Jesus knows what you need. Sometimes that is not what you think. Sometimes we want Jesus to take things away from us. And sometimes he doesn't do that, but he gives us the strength to get through what we are facing. Sometimes he pulls us out of the situation. Sometimes he stands with us in the situation. When Jack was in NICU, when he was first born, He and us, we needed to go through that. So Jesus stayed with us rather than pulling us out of the situation. And Jesus provided for us in miraculous ways. But it was his peace. It was Jesus' peace that overwhelmed us. That counteracted what we saw with our eyes, what we could see in the natural. And I know that I've spoken to some of you who have faced some really scary and tragic things recently, that you have known that peace that just makes no human sense. When you look at the situation, the peace makes no human sense, but you have known that peace. And Jesus has many things he can give us. He can give us peace. He can give us joy. He can give us patience. He can give us his perspective on a situation. He can provide for us in miraculous ways. He can give us strength to face things. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are ready to give us what we need. For some of us, our encounter with Jesus today will be asking him for something we need that only he can give. Peace. Peace in our body, peace in our mind, peace in our spirit. Maybe the overwhelming understanding that he is in control, whatever it looks like. the understanding that Jesus is in control. Maybe it's the strength to just get through the day. Jesus, he knows what you need. Let's look at verse 38. Jesus says, "Why are you troubled and why do doubts rise in your mind? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Jesus can be trusted to keep his promises. Now, Jesus promised the disciples that he would come back to life. In Luke 9, it says, Jesus said, "The Son of Man," he's talking about himself, "the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day." Jesus promised the disciples that he would come back to life. And his hands are the evidence of this. Jesus keeps his promises. Whatever promise Jesus has made, he will keep it. Whatever promise Jesus has made, he will keep it. Here are some of the promises. I sat in these for ages. And if you did prepare the ground, we spent a bit of time. Oh, is that really small as well? Sorry if it is. In Matthew 11, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, for I will give you rest." Who here needs rest today? Come to Jesus as a promise there. John 8 says, "Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Jesus is the light. Who of you are feeling darkness around you today? Who of you are feeling darkness in your situations? Jesus is with you. This is my favorite verse in the whole Bible. "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Some of you have had some things stolen from you. Some of you have had some things stolen from you. Some of you have seen death. Some of you have seen destruction in different areas of your life. The promise of Jesus is that "I have come that they may have life." Have life in all its fullness. John 11, "Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying." Anyone who's feeling fear, when we die, we will be with Jesus. And the final one I've pulled out is, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you." I think that peace is something we all need today. So I've been preparing this. This is the word I've really felt for us. "Do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." I was listening to something this morning and it said that the translation of the peace in these passages, it's not about an absence. It's not about like an absence of conflict, but it's about a presence of something. And it's about moving towards something. It's about moving towards Jesus. That's the peace, not the absence of conflict, but the presence of Jesus. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are evidence that Jesus can be trusted to keep his promises. For some of us, our encounter today will be to be given the faith to trust that he will do what he says. His promises are true. His delay is not his denial. And we move on in our passage, verse 41. So Jesus asks them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish. I don't know what that is. It doesn't sound very nice, but anyway. And he took it and ate it in their presence. So Jesus wants to spend time with you. The fully resurrected, promise-keeping, gift-giving, full-bodied, alive and breathing Jesus is wanting to hang out with you. He is not rushing off. In Jesus' world, to share a table with someone was to say, "You are important to me. I want to know you. I give you value. I give you worth. You matter to me." Jesus is sat with you. He is interested in you. His attention is on you. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are eating with you, giving you value and worth. For some of us, our encounter with Jesus today will be realizing that you are honored in Jesus' eyes, that you matter to him, that he wants to spend time with you. Verse 45, it says, "Then he," Jesus, "opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures." Jesus wants to reveal things to you. Now, you may notice I'm someone who speaks with their hands a lot. When I was a teacher, it was a mannerism that I got most mocked for. Like, if I was ever roasted by the kids, it's because I use my hands a lot. And I'm held back by the microphone up front here. I've only got one hand to do anything with. And I regularly whack people as I get into telling stories. I'm sure I've whacked some of you in the connect area at the end. Because it's part of the way I explain and I share and I tell stories. And Jesus wants to give you wisdom and understanding of just who he is. As we spend time with him, he will reveal more of himself, more of his care and attention for you, more of the truths about the way that he sees you, the way he has made you, the things he has positioned and placed you for that no one else can do. He will reveal more of his heart for the lost and the broken and the displaced as we sit with him and read his word. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are teaching and explaining and sharing his heart with us. For some of us, our encounter with Jesus today will be him revealing some truth about himself to us. It will be expanding your understanding of who Jesus is. Today, for some of us, Jesus is going to expand our understanding of who he is. And finally, it says in verse 46, so he told them, this is Jesus again, this is what is written, the Messiah, he's talking about himself, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Jesus has rescued you. Jesus has made a way for you. Jesus died so our sins could be forgiven. He died to make way to the Father. He took on the punishment of our sin and paid the price so that we can be free from the penalty we deserved. God the Son dying in our place on the cross. As the song says so poetically, hands that flung stars into space to cruel nails surrendered. But Jesus rose from the dead, conquering death and defeating evil. This is what we preach. This is what we believe. It's the hands that give it away. And what are the hands doing? They are nail pierced, outstretched on the cross. They are now lifted in prayer for us. At this very moment, Jesus' hands are lifted in prayer. He is praying for us. It's the hands that give it away. For some of us, our encounter with Jesus today will be trusting him again and again and again for what he won for us on the cross. And that's how we're going to encounter him today. Through coming back to that place of the cross, of coming back to that place of encounter, that place of being filled. It says in verse 30, when he was at table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. We're going to encounter Jesus today in the bread and the wine. As we see Jesus using his hands to break the bread and his hands to lift the cup, asking us to remember what he was going to do on the cross. We encounter Jesus here and now with his nail-pierced hands held out to us, inviting us to come and share in his death and resurrection. Come and share in his death and resurrection as we share communion together. And at the very end of the passage, it says, Jesus says, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. The disciples were told to wait for the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in John 15 that the Holy Spirit would testify to us who Jesus is. It's the Spirit who helps us to encounter Jesus. It's why we pray for the Spirit to come. It's why we pray for you to be filled with the Holy Spirit, so we see more of Jesus. It's why we pray for you to be filled for the first time, or we pray for you to be filled again and again and again with the Spirit. Because when the Holy Spirit fills us, he shows us Jesus. We encounter the risen Jesus, and we encounter the power of Jesus that can transform situations, situations that we think are hopeless. He can transform situations that can cause dead things to come back to life. He can transform situations that can bring healing, that can restore and bring freedom. And I do believe that's what he wants to do here today. We eat the bread and wine to encounter Jesus. We pray to be filled with the Holy Spirit, that Jesus would be revealed more and more in our lives, that we would see his hand upon our lives and active in our lives. And we would like to offer both of those encounters now. Would you please stand? Let's just take a moment. I'm just going to ask the Holy Spirit to come. We're going to go into communion. But Jesus wants to encounter you today. And we're going to be doing that in two ways. We're going to be taking communion together. And then as you come forward for communion, there's going to be people who will pray for you, if you'd like to be prayed for, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And they're the ways that we're going to encounter you today. Worship team are going to be praying. We're going to open the space up. But I just encourage you. I'd encourage you to believe that Jesus wants to encounter you today. He wants to encounter you here today. And how he's going to do that is up to him. Let's just take a moment. Just come, Holy Spirit. Give us faith to believe that you want to encounter us today, Jesus, that you've got something for each of us today, whether that's through the bread and the wine, whether that's through being prayed for, whether that's through meeting you in worship. Give us faith to believe that you want to encounter every single one of us here today. Can we have the communion liturgy up? Is that okay? Brilliant. Thank you. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Would you like to sit? We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. If you're involved with distribution or praying, if you'd like to come forward now. There's going to be two stations at the front today. It's all non-alcoholic wine. Gluten-free option will be this side. Turning to my air hostess phone, be this side. And once you've received communion, there'll be people there who will happily just pray for you to be filled with the Spirit. It's not going to be anything strange or weird. We're just going to, if you're happy for us, lay a hand on you and just ask you to be filled with the Holy Spirit. But I'd encourage you just to engage with Jesus. Just believe that he's got something for you today, that he wants to encounter you today. And if you want to use the space at the front, if you want to stay at the front, that's absolutely fine. We will work around you. We've got time. We've got space. The worship band are going to be playing. It might get a little bit messy because we're not going to, you know, do the whole this way, that way. But why don't we stand? Let's say together, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Just come, Holy Spirit. Come and fill us now. As we take the bread and wine, as we're filled with the Spirit, would you just come now, Holy Spirit? Please come forward to receive.
open our ears.
Open our ears, open our hearts, we want to know. So God, will you draw near to us? God, will you draw
celebrate the fact that Jesus is alive today. Celebrate the resurrection life that we have in him. So let's sing together.
Because there is power in his name, for the stone is rolled away. Mountains bow. Of our great and matchless.
Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that you are a God who walks alongside us, a God who is close to us, a God who is for us, a God who is with us. And I pray as you leave this place, you would know the reality of that. And you know the reality and the blessing of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. In his name, amen. Amen. That draws our formal gathering to a close, but we're going to keep this space at the front here. If you'd like to be prayed for, maybe something was opened up earlier and you'd like some more prayer, that's fine. We'd love to pray for you. Keep this space at the front here free for prayer, but do stick around for refreshments. Two things just to mention. Men, there's a men's event coming up this Wednesday, and do have a look at that on the website. And similarly, 20s to 30s, there's a walk coming up on Saturday. All the details are online on our website. Please look at that. Think about coming. It'd be great to have you at either one of those events. God bless you. Hope to see you sometime soon.